How many of you remember this? My daddy left home when I was three. He didn't leave much, but my mom and me, this old guitar and empty bottle of booze. But I don't blame him because he ran and hid, because the meanest thing that he ever did was before he left, he went and named me Sue. Iconic Johnny Cash song. And that name becomes the theme of that song and the story that it's told, how it affected that individual and how came a time of confrontation about that name. I want you to take your Bibles and turn with me, Hosea chapter 1. And as you turn there, let me share with you that very often in the Bible and in other cultures, the name of a child means more than just how they're called to dinner. Today's sermon is about four of those names. They are tragic warnings, but these statements can also be blessed reminders of the depth of our walk with Jesus Christ. If you know the Johnny Cash song that I began, you'll realize that that song about a name is what formed this guy, and he finally takes the opportunity to meet the guy who named him that. And of course, at the end, if you're familiar with the song, you know, he says, every time I tried and every time I win. He thought about the fact that his father named him Sue, and it made him tough, and it made him what he was. And then he says, and if he ever had a son, he was going to name him Bill or George, anything but Sue. I still hate that name. Now, I don't know if I thought the first time I heard that he was going to say, I'm going to name him Sue, but it really made sense how Johnny Cash ended that. In the Bible passage we're going to look at, we're going to be introduced to three children. The book of Hosea is an incredible Old Testament book. I don't have time to go through what makes it so unique. But in it, almost everything in Hosea's life becomes a prophecy, has some prophetic thing about it, from the wife that he marries, from the children that she bears, from the waywardness of her life to his restoring of their marriage. His whole life becomes a prophetic message. We want to look into what just one part of this. Now, realize I am not a Hebrew scholar, nor do I claim to be, so I'm going to share with you two of the greatest deceptions mankind ever had. Here's the first. Ladies, permanent press. The second is self-pronouncing texts pronounce themselves. I still mess up names. So when we come to these names, you'll notice they may not be exactly as you heard them some other time before. Here's what the Word of God says. Hosea, the Old Testament book of Hosea, chapter 1. The word of the Lord came to Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, king of Israel. When the Lord began to speak by Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, go take yourself a wife of harlotry and children of harlotry, for the land has committed great harlotry by departing from the Lord. So he went and took Gomer to the Gomer, the daughter of Dibian, and she conceived and bore him a son. And the Lord said to him, call his name Jezreel, for in a little while I will avenge the bloodshed of Jezreel on the house of Jehu, and bring an end to the kingdom of the house of Israel. It shall come to pass in that day that I will break the bow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel. And she conceived again and bore a daughter. Then God said to him, call her name Loruamah. That might be as bad as Sue if you're a male. Of course, I mean, you could have a nickname like Lo. or Ru. But it'd not be a name you want to hear too many times. For this is what it means. For I will no longer have mercy on the house of Israel. But I will utterly take them away. Yet I will have mercy on the house of Judah. Will save them by the Lord their God. And will save them and will not save them by bow, nor by sword or battle, by horsemen, by horses or horsemen. Now when she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah and conceived and bore a son, then God said, call his name Lo-Ami, for you are not my people, and I will not be your God. Yet the number of the children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured or numbered. And it shall come to pass in the place where it was said to them, you are not my people. There it shall be said to them, you are sons of the living God. Stop there. Yeah, I read that right. Remember, this is Israel. This is in the northern kingdom. This would be close to a place called Galilee, where we know somebody came from whose name was Jesus. Then the children of Judah and the children of Israel shall be gathered together and appoint for themselves one head, and they shall come up out of the land, for great will be the day of Jezreel. Say to your brethren, my people, and to your sisters, mercy is shown. Lord, I pray in these next few moments, we'll look at names, look at what they mean, and look how we fit into that. For Jesus, I ask this in your name. Amen. In verse 4, we find that there is a son who is born, and his name is called Jezreel. Now, Jezreel in and of itself wasn't a bad name. There is a valley. It's called the Valley of Megiddo. It is also the Jezreel Valley. A lot of wars have been fought in this valley and in this plain. So it's not necessarily a bad thing. But in this case, the name is prophetic in that God is saying Israel, the northern kingdom, is no longer going to be a kingdom. It's going to go into the Assyrian captivity. It's going to be destroyed by the Assyrians. It's going to be laid level and low. The other thing I want you to see is that this passage talks about something from the past. And that's found in 2 Kings chapter 10, verses 29 through 31. How many of you remember the king of Israel whose name was Ahab? Not the guy who went after Moby Dick, but Ahab in the Bible. Who was his wife? Tell me I know. Jezebel. So Ahab and Jezebel. He was the king of the northern nation known as Israel. Two nations, Israel and Judah, after the time of Solomon. Sometimes they're used interchangeably as Israel, but in this case, it's clearly defined Israel, the northern kingdom, Judah, the southern kingdom. And in this particular case, we go back to 2 Kings, and what we have is the fact that there is a new regime that's going to take place under a fellow named Jehu. Jehu is going to take and he's going to depose Ahab, set up his own kingdom. The problem is that Jehu is pretty bloody about it. And he takes the opportunity to go through all of what Jezebel had done with the prophets of Baal, and he begins to systematically destroy that, and that's a good thing. What he doesn't destroy are the calves of Jeroboam that speak of idolatry. That's connected to what we talked about last week in Ezekiel, about what he saw in that vision. And so what happens is, he then takes, Jehu does, all the prophets of Baal and all the followers of Baal, and he deceptively says, you think Ahab and Jezebel followed Baal? Wait till you see me. And he invites them all. And does anybody remember what he does in 2 Kings chapter 10? He gets them all in from all over. And what does he do? He stops all the exits and sends his assassin squad in, and he kills everybody. Everybody who claimed to worship Baal. He then takes the opportunity to destroy the family of Ahab and Jezebel. But because he would not take those items of Jeroboam, God says, look, your dynasty is going to last four generations. Look at it there in 2 Kings and realize in Hosea, that's when we're coming to that fourth generation. They go against the Assyrians, and the Assyrians devastate them. They destroy the kingdom. Jezreel, the son of Gomer and Hosea, was the prophecy of that end. Tragic. Tragic in so many ways. Gomer conceives again, and they have a daughter, Loruamah. And this passage of scripture in verse 6 says that God is going to no longer be merciful to Israel. He's going to no longer be merciful. He's not going to protect them. He's not going to go before them. He's not going to keep them from the judgment that is to come. He's not going to keep them. Can you imagine a more devastating statement than I will no longer be merciful to you? Think, let me help you. Everything you have in the person of Jesus Christ is through the mercy and grace of God. Have you ever taken the opportunity to read the love chapter backwards? Well, no, I've never thought of doing that. What I mean by backwards is not backwards from right to left and from the bottom to the end. But where it says, where there is love, have you ever gone through that and said, where there is no love, there is this? Try that sometime. But in this case, he says, look, there's no more mercy. I'm done. Now that's to a point, because what you find in the rest of Hosea is the fact that he says, I'm going to bring you back. I'm going to redeem you. I'm going to restore you. But the nation is done. The nation is done. And the mercy that I had upon you for a period of time is going to be non-existent. My hand of protection is off you. I used to take the opportunity to direct youth camps in a place called Suncrest Camp, which is over by Pittsburgh. And when I first began doing these camps and youth camps, and you know, I heard all sorts of horror stories about raids, cabin raids. So I simply told the girls this. I said, I will personally guarantee you that no guy will come into your cabin. No guys will personally raid your cabins. We're doing away with this. Just want you to know, these guys will not raid your cabin. Gave them my personal guarantee. And I told the guys what would happen to them if they did. But I also told the girls, if you raid the guys' cabin, my hand of protection comes off. So somebody had to take me at my word somewhere. So one camp I directed, everything was fine. We had no raids. Another camp I directed, fine, no raids. Third camp I directed, the girls decided, we don't need your hand of protection. So they raided a cabin. A seventh grade boy cabin. And so off we go to the pool one day, and I hold back that cabin. And I said, you have 5 minutes. Do you know how much destruction can be done by a group, a cabin of boys in 5 minutes? They had some rules. First of all, they could not go into any suitcases. If I caught them, that was it. And these guys abided by the rules pretty good. Didn't see anybody in any suitcases, but they totally dismantled the girls' cabin. Took all the bunk beds apart. Smeared peanut butter and toothpaste on doorknobs and other places that people were going to handle in 5 minutes. Now, of course, not one of them was quiet when we got to the pool and they told, wait till you get back, wait till you get back. And then I heard this, oh, Jonesy, you did it, oh, Jonesy. Whoa, huh? What was the deal? I guarantee you, they would not raid you. Gave you my personal guarantee. But if you raided them, my hand of protection was off. Now that's a funny thing. But could you imagine the hand of God's protection being off? And that's what happened to the northern kingdom, Israel, at the judgment hand of God through the Assyrians. When again, Gomer conceives, we have Lo-Ami. Verse 9, he says, you're no longer my people. Now remember that he is going to use the rest of Hosea to tell them he's going to restore them, redeem them. But for that time, right now, no longer you're my people. No longer you have so committed idolatry. You have so acted a harlot towards me and my message. That this is a judgment that is reaped upon you, and you are no longer my people. No longer my people. In many of the areas of our ministry in the Christian Missionary Alliance, we take the opportunity to find ourselves in cultures that are not Christian. And every once in a while, what we will hear is a convert from a majority religion in one of these countries who are disowned by their family. Disowned by their family. In some of those cases, it's a very, very dangerous thing because in some of these families, if a child is disowned for converting to Jesus Christ, they can be killed. They can be murdered. They can be hunted down. But could you imagine what it would be? Be told by God, you're no longer mine. You're not my people. You're not my people. I want that to sink a minute. Because these are incredibly tragic. They are horrific things to think about. And they're naming beautiful little children this. And all the time where they're growing up, they're, oh yeah, you're LaRuma, you know. God's going to be no longer merciful to me. Can you imagine them in first grade? And if they last into, you know, junior high, how cruel things can be there? These children, they became part of the prophetic word of God. Now, there's one other name that I want you to look at, and that name is Ichabod. It is not in this text. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 4, verse 21. And the word Ichabod means the glory is departed. Now, this happened after the Ark of the Covenant was captured. Eli and his son die. And all of a sudden, what we find is that the statement of the wife of Eli's son, who bore a son, when they ask, what is his name? Calls him Ichabod. Now, like you, Mom, excuse me, maybe some of you, your first connection with the name Ichabod came from Sleepy Hollow, Ichabod Crane. Yeah, I don't know who Ichabod was or what it was. Then I became a believer, began taking the opportunity to study the Word of God, and here was this term, Ichabod. Ichabod. It means the glory is departed. I remember hearing a preacher in a sermon that I heard one time, and he says, if this happens in this congregation, you might as well stick Ichabod over the door. And I couldn't understand why Ichabod Crane would be over the door. Until I understood this prophecy. Ichabod, the glory has departed from Israel. The glory has departed. And it wasn't restored until David brought the ark back. The glory has departed. Four names that are unusual to us. Four names that in this biblical text are a lot like that name Sue, given to Johnny Cash's song's character. It had an effect upon them. It had a message about them, or a message from God about them. And I've tried to share with you what these names meant in the context of Assyria coming and taking that northern kingdom in defeat. You would say, well, you know, preacher, that's not a very good story. Man, I know winter's getting to you, buddy, but you know, you don't have to be so morose. Why would you come share this with us? And I'll do that because, you see, I know another name. I know another name. Everything you see in Jezreel, Loruamah, Loami, and Ichabod, all of them, did I mention all of them? All of them could have been averted. None of these names had to mean what they mean if these people would have confessed and repented and knew the forgiveness of God, if they'd have come back. Not one of these horrible, tragic things would have ever befallen them, ever, if they would have remained true to God. So I know another name, and that name is Jesus. And in Revelation chapter 19, verse 16, it says that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It tells me that he has a kingdom. He's coming to establish that earthly kingdom for 1,000 years. He is coming to establish that kingdom in his return, where all the promises of Israel are fulfilled. He is coming for that earthly kingdom, but he has a kingdom right now. A kingdom that will one day be all summed and totaled in what we call heaven. Not only does he have a kingdom, he is called a church. He is called the church. Jesus said, "This is my church. And the gates of hell will not prevail against it." It's his church. I want to tell you something. You know this, so this is not a secret. Are you ready? Christianity and the church are indivisible. You cannot be a Christian and not be part of a church. Oh, no, you don't understand. I'm saved by grace. Yeah, you're saved by grace, but believers find themselves in communities. Those communities are called churches, and Jesus has one. You part of it? Jesus has a church because I know another name. I know another name other than Jezreel. No longer a kingdom. I know a name. And in that name, he is crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords. In that kingdom, he rules and he reigns. In that kingdom, he is high and lifted up. And in the church, he has a people who are called by his name. He has a family. I know another name. You know that name? I thank God that I am a citizen of the United States. But there is another citizenship that claims my loyalty first, and that is the fact that I am under the blood of Jesus Christ, and I am his and his kingdom first. I thank God that he is merciful to us. I couldn't imagine the idea of God saying, I'm no longer going to be merciful for you. I'm going to take my hand of protection off you. The Assyrians are going to come into your cities and into your homes. They're going to pillage them. They're going to kill you. They're going to make you bereft of anything. That's what happens in history through Hosea's prophet and through his naming of his daughter, Loruamah. But I know another name. His name is Jesus. And in Matthew chapter 1 in verses 21 through 23, he is proclaimed to be the Savior. He's proclaimed to be God with us. In the scripture, he came to seek and to save that which is lost, and he is not willing that any should perish. I know another name. I don't have to stand. In the prophetic wake of Loruamah, no longer merciful, I stand in the mercy of a God who loves me and who gave himself for me. I stand in that type of relationship today. I am forgiven, and I will be forgiven, and I will be forgiven. And I, when I come and repent and confess, what will he do? You don't know? If I will repent and if I will confess, what will he do? One more time, a little more. Do you really believe that? He will forgive, and he will forgive all. He will restore me. He will place me back in right fellowship with him. I know another name. It's not Loruamah. I'll no longer be merciful to you. I know another name. And name is Jesus. And Jesus will come and to seek and to save me. And Jesus will come and be my Savior. And Jesus will come and let me know that it is God with us. He's with me and he's with you if you know him. I know another name. And if the people in Hosea's day would have come before their God with that repentance, with that conviction, with that confession, if they'd have come back, there'd have been that restoration, and it is going to come in the future. Third thing, he has another son, Lo-ami. Lo-ami, you're no longer my people. What must have gone through Israel's heart when they heard from the prophet that they were no longer God's people? It could have been averted, it could have been different, but it wasn't. But I know another name. What's that name? No, what's that name? I know another name. And in John chapter 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. That nothing was made that wasn't made by him. And that he was the light of men, and then the Word became flesh. Wait a minute. Jesus became one of us. As I shared in the basketball devotional, this is how we know that God loves us. First of all, that God came into our world. Secondly, that Jesus Christ died on the cross. And thirdly, Jesus Christ rose from the dead. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld the only begotten of the Father. He is the Son of Man and the Son of God. And he is calling out a people who are pleasing to him. He's not saying, no, 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 you're not my people. He's opening his arms and says, come be my people. Come be my people. Come be my people. I know another name. And it's not Lo-ami. But it will be a name that I have to bow my heart and my spirit to. It will be a name that I have to give my life to. It will be a name. It will be a name. I know another name. Then finally, the one I picked out of the Old Testament in 1 Samuel, Ichabod. You know, the glory didn't have to depart from Israel. If you read this, you'll find that Eli became the prophet who no longer prophesied the truth. He allowed his sons and others to pervert Israel. He allowed them to become bribe takers and to be immoral and to turn their face away from the living God. And he said when that ark was lost in battle, in the name of a child, a beautiful little child with a horrid name, my glory has departed. How'd you like to go through life with a name like that? Well, who's that? That's my glory has departed. Why is he named that? Because Israel lost the Ark of the Covenant. It lost a major part of their connection with God. And he reminds me of that. How do you think he was treated? But I know another name. Okay, maybe you don't. You're not smiling at me. I know another name. What's the name? Jesus. What's the name? Jesus. I know another name. Turn with me, if you would, in the Bible. Of course, where else would I have you turn? To the book of Philippians. In the book of Philippians, in chapter 2, it says this, beginning in verse 5, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God has also highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and on those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father." Look, Ichabod doesn't need to be written on any church door. Ichabod didn't have to be foisted upon the nation because it lost the ark. Ichabod only happens if you deserve it. But I know another name. Do you know another name? Oh, tell me what it is. I have another name. And this other name, I am taught and I am told, is full of glory. His other name talks about how his love and how his grace transforms and changes me. This other name, I trust, is written on your heart, written on your spirit. Jezreel, no longer a kingdom. Lo Ruhama, no longer merciful. Lo Ami, no longer my people. Ichabod, the glory has departed. Names. Names that have a prophetic voice to Israel. Their prophetic voice came into being because the people would not repent, because they would not confess, because they would not be restored. And these names didn't have to be given. Fast forward to you and me today. I know another name. I know another name. And as we close our service this morning, do you know another name? How are you called in that name? How do you walk in that name? How do you love in that name? The names of Hosea's children in Ichabod were worse than a boy named Sue. But I know another name. I know another name. Who answers and who establishes and who forgives and who restores. Can anybody here tell me what that other name is? Jesus. Let's stand together. Lord, in these passages of Scripture, we see where we will take ourselves without mercy, without grace, without forgiveness, without God. I also thank you for the fact that there is another name. And in that name, we're part of a family, part of a church, part of a kingdom. And in that name, we are a people. We have been called out to know Him, to love Him. And we are the people of mercy and grace because we're forgiven. And the glory is not ours. The glory is yours. And as long as we will pursue that, and as long as we will know that that's why we've been created and that's why we're yours, to bring you glory, Ichabod will never be named here. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I ask it. Now before I say amen, with your eyes closed and your head bowed, nobody looking around. Eyes closed, heads bowed. I'm closing my eyes. I'm bowing my head with you. This is really only between you and God. Only between you and God and the altar of your seat, the altar of this place. How many of you will raise a hand and say, Pastor, I know another name. I know another name. I know another name. Might we live it? Might we share it? I know another name. And it's that name, the name of Jesus, that I pray. And all the people said, Amen. Amen.